Good morning, everyone. My name is Pragati. I'm working as an assistant professor at St. Martin's Engineering College in the physics department. So today I will be giving a seminar on classification of magnetic materials. So how we classify the magnetic materials into diamagnet? We classify the magnets into diamagnet, paramagnet, and ferromagnet. So under diamagnetics, if you see a diamagnetic compound, we are having atoms in it, right? Once we have all atoms in it, we will be having the electrons which are rotating around the nucleus. So the electron rotating around the nucleus will be depicting only two motions. One is the motion that it will be depicting around the nucleus, which is called orbital motion, and the another motion it will be depicting with its own axis, which is called spin motion. So there is one motion which is called orbital motion, which it will be rotating around the nucleus as an axis, which is called orbital motion. And there is one more motion which is called spin motion, that it will be depicting like this. So on its own axis, your electron will be rotating around the nucleus once on its own axis, and one more movement on the keeping axis as a nucleus axis. So there is spin motion and there is orbital motion and spin motion. But in the case of diamagnetic material, we have the examples like zinc, copper. In zinc and copper, we are having fully paired electrons. Fully paired electrons are nothing but we are not having any unpaired electrons are not there. Only even number of electrons are there. If there are even number of electrons, we are not able to get here unpaired electrons. That means if there is an absence of unpaired electrons in the case of diamagnetic, the orbital motion of the electrons is getting cancelled by the spin motion of the electrons, and that's why we are not having any permanent magnetic moment for the case of a diamagnetic material. There is no permanent magnetic moment in the case of diamagnetic due to the cancellation of the orbital motion and the spin motion, because the number of the electrons in the case of diamagnetic are paired. The number of electrons are paired, and there are no unpaired electrons. Means there are no odd number of electrons. There are even number of electrons. So that is why your diamagnetic material doesn't have any permanent dipole moments. And in the case of paramagnetic material, if we see, the paramagnetic materials are those materials in which we are having unpaired electrons. Once we see if they are having unpaired electrons, in those particular unpaired electrons, if we are having unpaired electrons here, if we are having here the unpaired electrons, that means the orbital motion will not be getting completely cancelled by the spin motion of the electrons. All the electrons which are there, which are presenting the orbital motion, they will not be cancelling particularly your spin motion. That means, if suppose electrons are getting paired up like this, in this particular material, you will be also having the materials, also having the electrons which are unpaired. But in the case of this particular diamagnet material, all the other electron is paired. All the other electrons are paired. So there is no chance of getting unpaired electrons here, while in the case of paramagnetic material, we have got a chance of creating the unpaired electron, and that is why the orbital motion of an electron doesn't get cancelled by the spin motion of the electron, and that is why we are able to see permanent magnetic moment here. In this case, there was no permanent magnetic moment, but in this case, there arises a permanent magnetic dipole. But in the cases of the paramagnetic material, those all permanent magnetic dipoles will be randomly arranged. Once, if your all permanent magnetic dipoles are randomly arranged, then there will be no magnetization initially, right? Then the net magnetic dipole moment coming out of the all paramagnetic material will be zero. But here, in the case of diamagnetic, you are not initially having magnetic moment. You are not having any permanent magnetic moment. That is why in initial case, without applying any magnetic field, the net magnetic moment coming out of this is also zero. Now, in this ferromagnetic case, the same case appears as a paramagnetic. They are also having the unpaired electrons. They are having in less number, they are having in more number, that's why your ferromagnetic materials is strongly attracted to the magnetic field. So we'll start from the diamagnet, how it gets attracted. So your diamagnetic material, if we take a magnet, your diamagnetic material is weakly attracted towards the magnetic field, is weakly attracted towards the magnetic field. In case of the paramagnetic material, if we see, your paramagnetic material is weakly attracted to the magnetic field. This one is weakly repelled by the magnetic field. This one is weakly attracted by the magnetic field. In case of the ferromagnetic materials, your material is strongly attracted towards the magnetic field. This is the case of the strongly attracted. This is the case of weakly attracted. This is the case of weakly repelled. Right. Now, the next thing, we can differ the two materials again as, if I am taking a diamagnetic material and I am applying the magnetic field to it, north and south pole, I am applying the magnetic field to it, the many of the magnetic lines of force tend to pass away from the material. They tend to pass away from the material. So all the magnetic lines of force, only one or two will be passing from inside the material, and all the rest of the magnetic lines of force will be tend to passing away from the material. So that is why your magnetic permeability, the value of magnetic permeability is less than 1. It is very small, and even the magnetic susceptibility value, which is M by H. M is nothing but the magnetization produced in your material, and H is nothing but the magnetic force or the magnetic field, intensity of the magnetic field that you are applying. That is also is minus 1. That is also very small value. So this is in the case of a diamagnetic material. When you come to the case of a paramagnetic material, if you take a substance of a paramagnet and if you are applying the north magnetic field here, north pole and the south pole, your all the magnetic lines of force will be going inside. So again, since it is weakly attracted, many of the magnetic lines of force will be tend to pass from inside the material, but not much because it is weakly attracted. So there are lines of force which tend to pass inside the materials, and there are some lines of force which are passing through outside the material also. So it is weakly attracted by the magnetic field. Now, if you are coming to the ferromagnetic case, all the magnetic lines of force tends to crowd inside the material. So in here, the magnetic lines of force are avoiding the material. Here, they are passing through the material, but in this case, they are getting crowded in the material. So if at all we are taking here the ferromagnetic material, here it is north, here it is south, we are providing a magnetic field to it. So all the magnetic lines of force will be getting crowded inside the material, because it is strongly attracted towards the magnetic field. Since it is strongly attracted towards the magnetic field, they are getting all crowded inside the material. It is weakly attracted towards the magnetic field. That's why here we have the permeability is equivalent to 1. And even the susceptibility, which is M by H, is equal to 1, which is small positive value. Small positive value. Small positive value. Then again, if we see, the ferromagnetic material here, in the case of the ferromagnetic material, we are getting the magnetic permeability here as greater than 1. Greater than 1. And similar case with the susceptibility also. In the case of the susceptibility here, we are getting the susceptibility as a larger value, which is greater than 1. Susceptibility is again here, we are applying the magnetization by the magnetic force, magnetic field. Okay, so this is about the magnetic permeability, susceptibility. Here also magnetic permeability value, susceptibility value. So this is the first differentiation. Again, we can differentiate the three materials on the basis of suppose if we are applying a non-uniform field. Just now we have seen the case what we have applied the field L, which was a uniform field. Again, if I say I am applying a non-uniform field here, if I am applying a non-uniform field, non-uniform field in the sense, non-uniform magnetic field, non-uniform magnetic field, if I am applying the non-uniform magnetic field, in some parts of the magnetic field will be larger and in some parts of the magnetic field will be less. Means at some areas the intensity of the magnetic field will be high and at some areas the intensity of the magnetic field will be less. In this case of the diamagnetic material, your diamagnetic material will be always going towards from the strong magnetic field. From the strong magnetic field area, it will move towards a weak magnetic field area. Why? Because it is attracted, it is weakly attracted or weakly repelled by the magnetic field. That is why any dielectric, any diamagnetic material, if we keep under a non-uniform magnetic field, it will be always going from a strong magnetic field to the weak magnetic field. It will always switch positions from the strong magnetic field to the weak magnetic field. What happens in the case of a paramagnetic material? It is always going from the weak magnetic field towards the strong magnetic field. It always moves from the weak magnetic field towards the strong magnetic field. Come to the ferromagnet. If we are coming to the ferromagnetic material, it will be more strongly attracted by the strong magnetic fields. So wherever you are getting, in whichever areas the magnetic field value is very high, it will move from the weak magnetic field areas to strong magnetic field areas. So that is the case whenever you are applying a non-uniform magnetic field here. It is always going from the strong magnetic field area to a weak magnetic field area. But in the case of the paramagnetic and the ferromagnetic, since they are getting attracted towards the magnetic field, they are going from the weak magnetic field area to a strong magnetic field area. Next we are seeing here, talk about the examples of the diamagnetic material, that is NaCl solution, and if I am taking this particular NaCl solution in Petri dish, you all have known about the Petri dish. If this is a Petri dish, I am taking some NaCl solution in it, and here I am applying the magnetic field to it. When I pull the two of the bar magnets, when I'm putting them closer, north, south, when I'm putting them closer, the solution inside the Petri dish tend to move at the outwards. It tend to move the outwards because here, now when I'm putting them closer, here the strength will be higher. And you know the property of the diamagnetic, it will be moving towards the weak magnetic parts. It will be moving towards the weak magnetic field. So they will be tend to accumulate outer side of the magnets, not in the inside. They will tend to accumulate, the solution will tend to accumulate at the outer parts and not the inside. And the another case, if we are taking another case of magnetic field, which is north and south, this time I'm not putting the two bar magnets closer. I'm separating them by with some distance, and when I'm keeping this time the Petri dish and when I'm keeping the NaCl solution, this time they tend to accumulate in the middle. Why? Because now since the two north and south magnetic poles are a bit farther, the lines of force, the magnetic field strength is going to be minimum in the middle, and at the sides, at the poles, it is going to be the maximum. So where it is minimum, your diamagnetic weak is, since it is weakly repelled by the magnetic field, So it's tend to accumulate it here. Okay. Now in the case of paramagnetic material, the example in the case of paramagnetic material is salts of iron, salt solution of iron. Salt solutions of iron. So the similar, totally the opposite case happens here. So if I'm putting the north and south pole magnets, I'm applying an electric field, I'm keeping a petri dish here, and I'm putting the salt solutions of iron in the petri dish, they tend to accumulate in the middle. When the magnetic field is, strength is greater in the middle. When the strength is greater in the middle, they tend to accumulate in the middle because they are weakly attracted by the magnetic field. And if I'm tend to keep these two bar magnets apart, if I'm keeping apart by some distance, if I'm keeping this petri dish, they are tend to accumulate at the sides because now the magnetic field is more at the poles. Now the magnetic field strength is more at the poles and not at the middle. In the case of the ferromagnetic material, the similar case happens in the case of the ferromagnetic material. And here we have the examples like cobalt, nickel, and here we have the examples like aluminium. Here we are having the example as zinc and copper. Zinc and copper, in which we are seeing there are even number of electrons here, there are odd number of electrons here, and here there are odd number of electrons because still it is unpaired. If we see the hysteresis curve of a ferromagnetic material, if we are seeing a hysteresis curve of a ferromagnetic material, that is between the H, the applied magnetic force, and the magnetic flux density. And the magnetic flux density, this is the applied magnetic force and the magnetic flux density. If at all we are looking about the hysteresis curve, it will be increasing. Since the magnetic field is increasing, the dipoles will be getting the magnetic dipoles will be getting aligned towards the magnetic field. And when we are decreasing the magnetic field, since the material doesn't demagnetize completely, it is also leaves some value here. This is called remanent magnetization or remanence. This is called remanent magnetization, or we call it as reminiscence. Okay, it is taking a different path to be followed. And then again, if we are decreasing the magnetic field, it is not decreasing completely. See, if we are decreasing the magnetic field here, the magnetic field has become zero. The magnetic flux density has become completely zero. And there is still some negative direction field. The field is remaining. There is this field particular which is applied in the negative direction in order to make your magnetic flux density to go zero is called as cohesive field. Is called as cohesive field or coercivity. Again, if we are applying the magnetic force in the reverse direction, your magnetic dipoles will be getting aligned in the reverse direction. But in order to get aligned in the reverse direction, they will be losing out so much energy. That is why for some of the materials, the hysteresis curve comes to be fat. And for some of the materials, the hysteresis comes out to be thin. So what are the materials for which we get a fat hysteresis curve and for which materials we get a thin hysteresis curve? For a fat hysteresis curve, we get for the materials like steel. And a thin hysteresis curve we get for the material like iron and soft cores. Okay, in the case of, that is why we prefer iron more than the steel. Why we prefer iron? Because since it is a thin hysteresis curve, it is losing very much less energy. It is not consuming more energy to get demagnetized. That is why we prefer iron, soft iron over the steel.